Now, many of the big banks have released their first quarter numbers, and so far, so good, not too bad. Now, this morning, we're going to speak with the top guy at the banking unit of the Gutianan Group, EastWest Bank, Tony Moncupa. Hi, Tony. Good morning. Great to have you on the show, finally.
Thank you, Mimi. Good morning, everyone. Good morning.
Okay, so EastWest Bank has yet to release its report, but so far from the reports that we've seen, the pattern is, you know, benign credit growth. It's really the trading and FX gains that really carried through many of the players through the finish line. I mean, but just look at trading volumes today. Is that starting to fade? I mean, what's going to keep banks moving along now? Are you seeing improved fundamentals, for example, in deposits and loans moving forward?
Well, if you look at the numbers, as expected, the loans numbers are not really doing great. And that's really because of the uncertainties in the environment. You know, COVID is taking precedence over our economic activities. So companies are being careful on their investments. Consumers are also protecting whatever savings they have. And they have been more circumspect on their spending, particularly on big ticket items. So it's not a good sign yet at this point, no, because of this pandemic.
Mm-hmm. When you say not a good sign yet at this point because of the pandemic, are you seeing green shoots though? Are you seeing some bright spots at least?
I always tell our people here, you know, we see now the light at the end of this long pandemic tunnel. Mm-hmm. And the reason for that is because, of course, now we have the vaccines. We know that there are many vaccines still in the pipeline and the initial production of the vaccines being ramped up. And also importantly, the first world, the US, Europe, and all the rich nations are progressing very fast. Now, we all know that since they produce the vaccine and they are richer, they will get the first crack on the vaccines. But once they get over their needs, I think towards the end of the year, countries like the Philippines will start getting its share of the vaccines. So with all of these things, I think we're looking forward. We see light, except that the tunnel is too long.
Okay, so by your estimate, how long is this tunnel?
I think, you know, what's important is it's the perception of hope. I think towards the year end, as we proceed towards the year and we get into the latter part of the year, it is the hope that we will have the vaccines that would spur people to be a bit more bolder, so that investments will happen, spending could start to show progress, and that should revive the Philippine economy. And there's a lot of pent-up demand, and also I think everybody is just rearing to start up the economy.
But in the meantime, while that hope is not yet here, you're looking at end of the year, we're just in the second quarter. In the meantime, can you continue to depend on FX and trading gains?
You know, well, it depends. We need to clarify what we mean by depend. No? Of course, the banking industry in general, we got low probability last year. The industry ROE was 6.5%. That's down 33% from 2019. And if you look at the at 6.5%, that's really very low, not just barely above the risk-free rate. But in that sense, likewise, it's not that bad in the sense that we're still making, although very low profits, but the balance sheet is strong and it's ready to support the economy. So in the meantime, we'll just keep whatever we have. Now stay steady, stay firm, and prepare for the reopening of the economy. So I think that's what most banks are doing. We're attending to our operations, fine-tuning. We're looking at digital. How can we make our services more convenient for our customers? And all those things that we need to prepare so that when the gate opens, we will come speeding up and do whatever we need to do.
Tony, when you look at the bank earnings, provisions for loan losses remain elevated. We haven't seen your numbers for the first quarter, but do you think we've seen peak provisions already?
You know, I think so. If you look at the rest of the world, I think 2020 was the worst. And besides, the accounting rules that we have right now require us to anticipate bad loans and accordingly provide. provisions for loan losses. Fortunately, I think one of the biggest development, and I like to compare this to the 1997 financial crisis. Mm-hmm. This time we're coming in this crisis in a very strong position. Now, because of what the central bank has done with regards to the implementation of Basel III and all the reforms that has happened ever since that crisis, and also after the 2008 crisis in the West, there's more attention now to make sure that the bank's balance sheet are resilient. I think we're in a good position, even if the profitability is down.
Tony, I wanted to ask about loans. How profitable are the loans you give out today, given very low interest rates? We're at the record low benchmark policy of 2%. And where do you see the BSP or the central bank going with this?
You know, if you look at 2020, I think the banking industry lost on the loans in the sense that the provisions are bigger than the profits. If you look at total provisions for bad loans and you look at total profits, yeah, it's not a good sign. But it is 1 year and we're in for the long game. We don't look at it on a year-to-year basis, but we look at it as a fundamental business. We look at it as something that is sustainable. So the loans are not very profitable at this time. First, it's not growing. Our overhead, I think I could speak for the industry, and in general, we've kept it. I don't see a lot of banks cutting off their labor force. We've been supporting our people because we look forward this temporary pandemic. These two will pass, as they say. Mm-hmm. That happens, we'll have to be ready. Now, on the central bank, the question is about
where do you see the central bank going with rates? Do you think that their hands are tied or they have room to lower it some more? Have they done enough? Because everybody's saying the BSP has done more than enough.
Probably I'm one of those who will say that they've done what they have to do. They have kept monetary policy very loose. The financial condition is likewise supportive of the state of the economy. And they're trying to encourage or preventing a liquidity freeze. So now the challenge is there some signs of inflation is coming out. But I share the view of those who look at it that the inflation that we're seeing right now is transitory. It is caused by supply bottlenecks. You know, with the pandemic, people are not able to produce as they should. Supply chains are disturbed. So that there is a disbalance between supply and demand. And that would cause temporary spike in prices. But once the production gets going and as we normalize, as the vaccine starts getting in, then there'll be a catch up, but there'll be a lag. So the central bank state has taken that position, which means I interpret that they will keep monetary policy accommodative to support the economy. It's not yet in a position where it could stand the higher rates, I think. That's my view. Plus, we need to encourage investments. Likewise, we also need to encourage a bit more savings to those who, to those who can.
So Tony, you're not expecting rate hikes anytime soon, but are you expecting more cuts for the rest of the year?
I think the policy right now is just right. An increment, a further rate cut, I'm not sure it would have a big incremental value. And the risk of inflation, especially with the world recovering, commodity prices are going up, could be some potential downside to inflation. Mm-hmm. Although, you know, the school of thought says that it's supposed not to happen because, you know, unemployment is still very high, you know. So I don't think that's entirely that's really necessary at this point. We have loose enough monetary policy.
For monetary policy, let's try to look at the fiscal side because there is a push in Congress for Bayanihan 3 package. That's estimated to be around 420 billion pesos, another lifeline essentially. How critical is this third package from your perspective, and will it have material impact on banks?
You know, we are a 19 trillion economy. So 420 billion doesn't sound that much. No, it could help alleviate, especially the poorer segment of our countrymen. But to the extent of what will be the impact, you know, it doesn't seem to be humongous. Let's put it that way. Especially if you compare it with the, you know, bankers tend to look at things in relative terms, and we've seen how other countries have done it. But we also understand what we've read or what we've been hearing, that, you know, we need to also look at this as a long game. We're not the richest country. We need to protect and our fiscal position to support future growth. And all these policy debates are happening all over us. In the end, you know, I think any position you take, you could defend. But as they say, the test of the eating is in the pudding. Baliktad, no?
You said that like many years ago, Tony. You're still saying that cliche? So the stimulus is not so big, but what about FIST? Because you've got the FIST law. How attractive is FIST right now? Because it's supposed to allow you banks to unload your sour loans and have somebody else, another company, collect the loans for you. Is it attractive enough for you, or are you still planning to go at it alone, meaning collect the loans yourself, without sacrificing your margins?
You know, the FIST is really intended to make sure that the bank's balance sheets are strong so they could it could continue to support the economy. My view is, fortunately, the banking industry remains resilient, and that does not have the urgency that it did in 1997. Personally, for East West, I'm not very keen on it, because, you know, when somebody buys something, they got to make some money, right?
Yeah.
They got to make some money. Wherever they get the money, they got to get the money from somewhere. Right? No, but it really depends on your position. But I think we're in a good position, the industry as a whole. I'm talking the banking industry. And that's very positive, no? That there is less urgency, or there is less need for that. We were all just rearing to go lending if we could, because our portfolio has declined. Now, if you look at the whole industry, especially the consumer loans, the households have been very, very careful protecting whatever they have and trying to save. Because again, maybe I'd like to think it's because of the still remaining uncertainties with regards to the course of this virus. You know, we've seen India, we've seen other countries, and while I see that there is a definite end, that's for sure it will happen. But in the meantime, the road towards that end could be bumpy.
Bumpy. Moving on, Tony, to another interesting topic, Citibank. We heard that it was exiting retail in 13 countries, including the Philippines. Two local banks have already expressed interest. Are you interested? Is EastWest Bank interested seriously?
I think any bank in retail banking will pause and try to see the opportunity. We don't know enough data to say definitely we're interested, but it all depends with the specifics of the opportunity. But definitely, I think any bank who's serious about retail business, particularly in the side, because they got one of the dominant, they're one of the top credit card issuers. They got a very healthy wealth management for the mass affluent and even the emerging affluent. They get a good deposit base on the retail side. So it's a business that I think will interest a lot of banks. Some are just not saying anything, but I think they're taking the same stance. You know, it's very hard to be definite and things, but it certainly is interesting.
Okay, certainly interesting. Do you have plans to raise funds this year, either from the stock market or other means?
Money now is not very difficult. As I said, we have loose monetary policy because we always raise deposits. Now, the capital market is a bit of a challenge. But fortunately, I think if you look at the capital adequacy of banks, it's very high. It's somewhere about 14-15%. By any standard, that's a lot of leg room. That's a lot of room to maneuver. So if ever there's one, I think the fundraising involved could be handled by many of the stockholders, the dominant stockholders of the banks.
Okay, and speaking of banks as an investment, many of the analysts we talked to, Tony, say that banks are cheap today. But given the valuation plus the outlook that you have, the long tunnel, but you're seeing the light, from an investment point of view, do you think banks are still attractive investing in banking stocks?
Definitely. I think in the long run, and given the conservative way the industry is handling itself and the regulators are governing it, I think banking is a very good investment. It's tied to the economy. If you believe in the economy, you should buy banks.
Yeah. Okay.
Closely to the economy.
Well, you know what they say, banks are products of their economy. And if you believe, yeah, as you mentioned, the economy is going to recover, then this is going to be part of it. Tony, always a pleasure picking your brain. Thank you so much for joining us. I know you're a very busy man, but really appreciate the time and the insights.
Thank you, Mimi. Good morning.
See you soon. Stay safe.
Bye.